ओके हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज फ्रॉम फिजियोलॉजी क्लासरूम एंड टुडे लेट अस टॉक अबाउट द लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर। ओके, नाउ इन द लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर आई ऑलरेडी फर्स्ट डिस्कस द शॉर्ट टर्म रेगुलेशन। ओके, इन द लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर व्हाट इज बेसिकली द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन। फर्स्ट राइट, व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर, लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर। फाइन, सी लॉन्ग टर्म रेगुलेशन ऑफ ब्लड प्रेशर इज व्हेन एवर यू हैव आई विल से लाइक दिस एंड देन यू विल अंडरस्टैंड। इफ आई हैव अ इंक्रीज इन द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर वॉल्यूम, इफ यू हैव एन एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर फ्लूइड वॉल्यूम एक्सपेंशन, व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इज यू विल हैव अ राइज इन द ब्लड वॉल्यूम and that means you will have a rise in the blood pressure, isn't it? And this rising pressure is going to affect your kidneys. What? Kidneys will excrete more water and they will also try to throw the sodium out. This concept is called pressure natriuresis. Pressure natriuresis. Fine? Okay? So what happened? The pressure increased. That pressure told the kidneys to excrete more water. That means I will say this is a pressure diuresis. Okay. And that also told the sodium to come out of the kidney because they say volume is more. So more, throwing of the sodium in the urine. This is called pressure natriuresis. Who started this pressure diuresis and pressure natriuresis? Increase in the extracellular volume, which led to the increase in the extracellular blood pressure, isn't it? BP. Fine. So, what is the purpose of pressure natriuresis and pressure diuresis? Dash. What is the effect of pressure natriuresis and pressure diuresis? What they actually want to do? They want to decrease the BP. They want to bring the BP towards normal. I can't say decrease. Okay, I will say towards the normal. Towards the normal they are bringing it. Okay. So can I say this is actually a long-term mechanism? You are actually throwing the sodium. Okay. And water also. So you're actually doing something for a long term. Okay. So what is the, no, what is the effect of salt? What is the effect of salt on your BP? See, we have discussed that salt. Salt, the situation when we said the salt in the physiology of the fluids, we said salts, if you increase the salt in the body, you are actually increasing the osmolality. You are increasing the osmolality of your body fluids, isn't it? Body fluids. You are increasing the osmolality of the body fluids. And this osmolality was stimulating your, tells you to drink more water. That is, it stimulates your thirst center. Thirst center. Okay. Fine. So you will drink more. You will drink more water. So that you can cause dilution or concentration of the ECF. Are you doing this to dilute the ECF or concentrating? You are actually diluting the ECF. You want to dilute it. You want to dilute it. Very nice. Okay. And this will cause dash, increase in the ECF volume. Again, it will cause increase in the ECF volume. Second thing which this osmolality will do is it will tell, it will go to the posterior pituitary because blood is flowing everywhere. So posterior pituitary it's going. And in the posterior pituitary, it tells the posterior pituitary to secrete a hormone. Now you have a high concentrated blood. Do you want to सर इंक्रीज और डिक्रीज इन द ईसीएफ, अगेन आई विल से व्हाट हैपेंड इन द बिगिनिंग, यू टुक मोर सॉल्ट मींस यू इंक्रीज द ऑस्मोलैलिटी, मींस नंबर ऑफ पार्टिकल्स गॉट इंक्रीज्ड, नंबर ऑफ मोल्स ऑफ सॉल्यूट गॉट इंक्रीज्ड, दैट विल एक्चुअली टेल द थर्स्ट सेंटर, ओ माय गॉड आई हैव लेस वाटर इन द ब्लड, द ब्लड हैज लेस वाटर कंटेंट एज कंपेयर टू सॉल्यूट्स, सो दे विल टेल यू टू ड्रिंक मोर, सो यू ड्रिंक मोर वाटर, व्हाट विल हैपन, यू विल इंक्रीज द ईसीएफ, इजंट इट, व्हाटएवर यू ड्रिंक कम्स टू द ब्लड. So for this you should understand the basic physiology. Now clear this question? Okay. What can this osmolality also do? It can also tell at the same time to the posterior pituitary that please don't let the water get lost from the body. Isn't it? Do you want water to get lost from the body when you are in a state of, you know, more solute? High osmolality, no. You want to conserve the water. So will you produce antidiuretic hormone? I am not saying the name. I am saying will you cause something to produce an anti so that diuresis does not happen. Diuresis means you are passing the urine. So you will produce ADH from the posterior pituitary. ADS will be produced. This ADH will cause more reabsorption of fluid, increases the reabsorption because you have increased osmolarity. Why? Because you don't have water. Osmolarity is defined as number of particles per unit that volume. So particles will increase. So if I have a beaker and I have, for example, here 100 particles in 100 ml water, for example. Now I am telling you this 100 ml I am draining this 100 ml. Do you think that the number of particles are now increased? Now you have 150. Are we clear? It's a common sense, guys. You have 150 now. Don't tell me, sir. Please make us understand also this. It's common sense. It's no robot from the Mars can come and then tell you. Okay. It's common sense that posterior pituitary will definitely don't try. He does not want the water to get drained. He will stop the kidney. He will tell the kidney, oh, please don't lose the water in the urine. Try to conserve it. So you have a reabsorption. No, you have reabsorption happening in the tubules. So reabsorption will happen and more water will be conserved. So from the distal renal tubule, you will have increased absorption. Distal renal tubules. You will have increase in the reabsorption. What you are finally going to do? Again, sir, ECF will expand. We are going reaching to the same conclusion. So should they be in the long term? Because we said hormone is also in the, causing that. Okay. So this will be also the, that means you should be able to stimulate this hormone also. You should have a mechanism. And that's what we are studying. We are going to study a system, which is basically slow system. But is used in the, I had a question last time, someone of you had asked the question that as a doctor, what we are doing. So I did not answer you at that time because now I will be telling you as a doctor where we are actually having a role in decreasing the BP. It is this system where we are playing. Okay. It is this system where we as a doctor play to decrease the BP. There are also other mechanisms like CCB we give. We are giving potassium channel openers. We give, atrenergic blockers, vasodilator and all that, decreasing that BP. Here you will be giving a drug. What do you give every day in everyday life? I will be telling you some drugs also. Okay. So this system is important to understand. That is called the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Renin. Let me zoom a bit. Renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Okay. Call it in the other name as RAS. Please. Have a full concentration here. Okay. I'll make it easy. Simple as that. Okay. See guys, how to speak? Let me start like this. You have to see the organs which are doing this. So the game starts with an organ called kidney. Okay, the game starts with kidney. So this is your kidney. Okay, and the other player in this game is let me make a big rule here. Another player is the lungs. Another player is the lungs, guys. Okay. Fine. Next player, who is there is liver. Okay. You also have on the kidney what? Adrenal, suprarenal gland, isn't it? So I will draw this as separately. Okay, I will draw this separately as like this. This is your adrenal. Yeah, adrenal. What to write, medulla or cortex? Yes, guys, I have taught you. Adrenal. Where are the other people? So why cortex? Why did you say cortex? Why not medulla? Yeah, why cortex? Aldost, you know, very nice answer. So let us draw the cortex for you. Okay. So this is your adrenal cortex, fine. This is another player. Next player will be, there should be also one player who is, his name is posterior pituitary. So if I draw, so this is your anterior pituitary and this is your posterior pituitary. Fine. Okay. And this is your principal cell. This is your principal cell. Okay. Here on the tubule. So this is the principal cell. Principal cell. Fine. This is your blood vessel. Clear? Can we see the players now? Fine. So, by the way, what is the first function of this renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system? If you say broadly categorize the functions, I would say the purpose, listen to my words, the purpose is to, one, intravascular volume preservation. Number two, mean arterial pressure preservation. Okay. Fine. So what happens to this? Let us remove this, not to make diagrams more dirty. See what happens, guys. To understand this concept, I want your brain to get an attention on a diagram again where we can understand. Okay. So if you know the structure of the kidney tubule, isn't it? Do you know the structure of the tubule? Okay. So let me make it for you. You know that if I make a simple diagram, we have glomerulus, we have a Bowman's capsule, isn't it? Bowman's capsule, and this is the mesh of capillaries here, isn't it? We have a mesh of capillaries. So we have one thing which is coming as afferent arteriole, and we have another as efferent arteriole, isn't it? Efferent arteriole. So this is afferent coming, efferent going, exiting. Fine. And you know, you had that macula densa cell. You had macula densa cell. Do we remember macula densa cell? I had taught you in the anatomy, guys. Yeah. So see, that macula densa cell was more nearer. That macula densa cell was more nearer, like this. See, if I draw, this is the loop of Henle, for example. I'm just drawing a rough diagram, please. Don't think it's anatomical. And you had something near to this, isn't it? Isn't it? So we said this was macula densa, isn't it? Guys. Yeah, exactly. So can I draw another macula densa here? Macula densa. Isn't it? There are so many tubules. So I can draw it here. So macula densa, I am drawing it here. Okay, fine. You have macula densa. Clear? I'm going very much slow. Okay. Now see, guys, what is happening. What are the cells lining this afferent arteriole? These are called, we have cells here called juxtaglomerular cells. Juxtaglomerular cells. Okay. What cells are present here? Let me make a star for you. This place. What cells are here, guys? Anyone? Yeah. This. Star. Blue star I have made. These are Lacy cells. I have taught you, but you have forgotten. Lacy cells. Okay. Lacy cells. Okay. Guys, I think I have done a mistake, isn't it? I think I have done a mistake. Do you think I have done a mistake? I have drawn afferent very much dilated, and this efferent very much constricted. Is it right or not? It's right. The diagram is right. It is telling us something. Can you see the afferent arteriole is very much broad and efferent is very much narrow? The reason for this is that this is because this is dilated because of prostaglandins. This region is dilated. You can see a dilation, isn't it? There is a dilation because of prostaglandins. Because of prostaglandins. And this becomes constricted because of angiotensin II. Okay. Are we clear in this moment? Okay. Now here, have a look at me. See, guys, I will take a yellow color. Okay. Blood is coming through this region. Blood is coming. It is flowing in this. Okay. Okay. If I narrow this region, where will the pressure increase? upstream pressure will start going up, downstream pressure goes down. The upstream pressure, isn't it? Upstream pressure will go up. So here pressure should increase. Here pressure should increase. Will you actually cause an increase in the glomerular filtration rate? Will the more of the blood pass through this? Not blood actually, the filtrate. Are you increasing when you constrict more, when you constrict the efferent arteriole more? Are you actually increasing the hydrostatic pressure inside like a pipe? Are you increasing the hydrostatic pressure more? Yeah, because this was the exit point. I close all the exit gates. Are you actually increasing the pressure? Yes, increasing the pressure. So are you increasing the hydrostatic pressure? Yes, sir, increasing the hydrostatic pressure. Are we clear? Are we clear, guys? So you have finally what the effect, if I say constriction of efferent arteriole causes dash on GFR. Constriction on efferent arteriole causes dash in the GFR. Dash in the GFR, guys. You have to answer me to understand this concept. This is what you'll be doing in the wards every day, treating your patients. If you know this diagram, you can actually treat the people. Beautiful answer. You will increase the GFR. You will increase the GFR. That's a very nice answer. Okay. Very nice. Very nice. Very nice. Okay. Very good. Should I give a drug here? Should I tell you a drug which can keep it more dilated? Yeah. Should I tell a drug? Do you know those drugs? NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Let me take. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Non-steroidal. Anti-inflammatory agents or drugs. You know what they do? Like you have your paracetamol, acetaminophen, diclofenac, sodium. You know what they do? They do many things, but here on the renal tubule I am talking, they actually inhibit this prostaglandin. They inhibit, please remember, they inhibit this prostaglandin. Now tell me, if you inhibit the prostaglandin, will you cause constriction of afferent arteriole or dilation? Very nice answer. You will cause constriction. It will cause constriction. Very nice answer. Because who was ideally keeping it dilated? Prostaglandin was making it dilated. But you inhibited the prostaglandin. What happened? NSAID inhibited the prostaglandin. You are not able to keep it dilated. Who is having any doubt with this? Believe me, if you understand this concept here, you will be able to learn medicine, nephrology, drugs, treating the BP. If you have this diagram in your brain, clear? Who was causing efferent arteriolar constriction? Yes, guys, come on. Angiotensin 2, beautiful answer. Angiotensin 2, very nice. Can I give any drug which can inhibit this angiotensin 2? Yes, sir. There are drugs, for example, angioase inhibitors. We call them ACE inhibitors. What is the meaning of ACE inhibitors? Angiotensin. I will be telling you why we are using them. Angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. That means these enzymes must be converting something to angiotensin. And that means this angiotensin 2 will not be made if you inhibit that enzyme. Isn't it? This angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. That means if you inhibit this enzyme, you won't be producing angiotensin 2. This was producing angiotensin 2. So will you have efferent arteriolar constriction or dilation? different arteriolar vasoconstriction will happen. Different arteriolar vasodilation, sorry, will happen. Okay, very nice, very nice. Dilation will happen. Very good. Very nice, people. Okay. So will you, after giving ACE inhibitor, or there is another also one, that is ARB. ARB means angiotensin receptor blocker. Angiotensin receptor blocker, that is blocking it. So if you give these two drugs, what will happen? Will it cause efferent arteriolar dilatation? Yes, sir, it will cause efferent arteriolar dilatation. Will you actually increase the GFR or decrease the GFR? Will these drugs increase the GFR or decrease the GFR? Beautiful answer. They will decrease the GFR. Very nice answer. Because it was because of this constriction. Very nice, beautiful. Everyone is answering so beautifully. We are understanding blood pressure, the beautiful concept, which I loved since my first year. Actually, I was more concerned about these vessels and heart in my first year, you know. Yeah, more concerned about this heart. What can I do? Can't do anything. Okay. So, this is the drug which you are giving. Okay. Very nice. You have understood this. Very nice. I'm happy. Do we basically know that there was this, what was this efferent arteriole going into from the basics I have taught in the previous videos? This efferent arteriole is finally joining what? This efferent arteriole was finally joining dash. It was finally joining the paratibular capillaries. Do we remember the paratibular capillaries? Do we know that we had aorta, we had renal artery, interlobar artery, arcuate artery, cortical artery? I told you at that moment that you have to listen to this lecture carefully to understand. So I won't be making the repetition of that thing again and again. Okay. Fine. So I had taught you last time. Okay. For the people who are new, when you have any arterial supply of the kidney, this kidney artery will come, for example, from the hilum. This is an artery. So artery is coming. When artery comes, artery is basically coming from the aorta. From the aorta, you have a renal artery, isn't it? Renal artery breaks into segmental arteries, isn't it? Segmental, segment, 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 segment. It breaks into segmental arteries. Okay, segmental artery breaks into interlobar artery. Interlobar artery. Interlobar artery will break into, yeah, come on, arcuate artery. Arcuate artery. I have given you the mnemonic also, isn't it? Racia. Racia, isn't it? So arcuate artery. Then interlobular artery. Interlobular artery, guys. Isn't it? Interlobular artery will go into, yeah, afferent arteriole. Afferent arteriole. Now can we understand afferent arteriole is coming like this? Yeah. Sir, afferent arteriole. Exactly. Afferent arteriole, and then into glomerulus. This is glomerulus. Let me make here glomerulus. And then this glomerulus comes from the efferent arteriole. Can we understand? Efferent arteriole. And from the efferent arteriole, we are making paratibular capillaries. Paratibular capillaries. New students, can you understand how this efferent arteriole came? Can you understand how this efferent arteriole came? I have connected anatomy here also. Fine. So we had paratibular capillaries, then we had paratibular capillary joining again to form the veins, going into the interlobular vein. Interlobular vein. And in the interlobular vein, it came into the arcuate vein. Can we understand this blood vessel? I'm just making you understand this blood vessel, not anything about GFR, anatomy. Fine. So then arcuate vein, it went into the interlobar vein. And then again, it came into the renal vein, and then you have filtered it. Who is having any doubt with this? It was a review. For understanding this, you should go to my histology lectures. Okay. I have taught in the histology, by the way. So no need of here explaining you one by one. Fine. So in the anatomy of kidney, we will be learning it again. So don't worry. We are teaching you many times everywhere. Now, I want you people to again have a look here. What is the functional unit of your kidney? फंक्शनल यूनिट सिंपल क्वेश्चन सर, इट वाज टॉट इन एलकेजी। सिंपल फंक्शनल यूनिट ऑफ किडनी इज नेफ्रॉन, फंक्शनल यूनिट ऑफ किडनी इज नेफ्रॉन। एंड सर नेफ्रॉन वाज हैविंग सम पार्ट्स लाइक द सेम नेफ्रॉन वी मेड अबो, इजंट इट? वी हैव मेड दिस नेफ्रॉन, वी वेंट फ्रॉम द किडनी टू दिट्स माइनर यूनिट, इजंट इट? दिस वाज अ ग्रॉस ट्रस एंड देन फंक्शनल यूनिट वी सॉ स्ट्रक्चरल आल्सो। So this is a kidney and this is the one glomerulus I am taking. Okay, one nephron I am taking. This is the structure of nephron, isn't it? You have drawn it so many times. And we have this dilated portion. Okay. And then we have, I'm not making it perfect. I don't need to have it perfect. We're learning physiology. Okay. I'm not making it perfect right now because I'm not concerned with whole kidney. I'm just concerned with some cells. So you may remember, this is called the PCT. This is called the PCT. What is PCT? Proximal convoluted tubule cell. Proximal convoluted tubule cell. This is called thick ascending limb. Thick ascending limb of Henle. Isn't it? Thick ascending, isn't it? Thick ascending. So you remember Talah, Talach or Talha, Talach. Okay. So Talach is important basically. You should understand in the nephrology department. This is your PCT cell. This is your PCT cell, guys. Okay. And you know, if this is a PCT, this is your DCT. This is your DCT. And this region here is the principal cell. You have principal cell, and you have intercalated cells, and you have, this is a collecting duct, isn't it? And you have, if this is crossing, this is the cortex and this is the medulla, so this should be medullary collecting duct, isn't it? This should be medullary collecting duct, so this region should be medullary. I have taught you last time, isn't it? Medullary collecting tubule. Duct, and this should be a cortex, by the way, not medulla. This should be the cortex, isn't it? Cortex collecting duct. This region, isn't it? Because I taught you the regions last time. So this is a cortex region, this is the medulla. So medullary collecting duct is this. This will be cortical collecting duct, isn't it? Yeah. Yes, I hope you are understanding because I have taught this already so many times. So we are just integrating. If you have missed your classes, then it's unfortunate. I can't do anything. Okay, but still, I hope you are understanding what I mean. And you don't have, will not be having any problem because I have to work with some cells only. Okay. Now, you had this afferent arteriole and efferent arteriole. You had, now I draw afferent like this. Okay, I draw afferent like this. This is my afferent and here I'm having that glomerulus and then efferent should be drawn. Efferent should be, this should be drawn thick and this should be drawn thin. If angiotensin is working here. Okay. And here, you know, prostaglandin is there. And now this will be joining with, because you have filtered now everything. Now blood is coming like this. Now I'm changing the diagram. Okay. It will be reaching the peritubular capillaries. And then again, that story of inferior vena cava and everything. Okay. Is it, are we oriented, guys? Who is having any difficulty in this diagram? Is it difficult? No, sir, it's not difficult. Okay, very nice, beautiful answer. Now listen to me, see what is actually happening. To make it more interesting is that when you are having, basically, these tools we have kept in the hand, okay. We have tools in the hand. Fine. Isn't it? We have tools in the hand. Okay. Okay, guys. Now let us begin this RAS system. Okay. See, guys, what is happening. When you have, who is stimulating this RAS system? Who is the trigger? Reduced renal blood flow. You should write first. So RAS system, you should write the RAS system. stimulus is reduced renal blood flow. Reduced renal blood flow. That means, for example, a patient of dehydration, isn't it? For example, a patient of dehydration. Fine. Okay, easy. And if this reduced blood flow is happening, if this reduced blood flow is happening, who will sense this? Who will sense this? Macula densa will sense this. Macula densa is a sensor. Macula densa is a sensor. Okay. So macula densa will sense this. Sensed by macula densa. Sensed by macula densa. By the way, if they give you an example in the exam, if they tell you, if they ask a question like this, you had a decrease in the, can I say also that decrease in the BP will also activate this? Decrease in the BP will also activate this. Isn't it? Decreased BP. And you know, renal system has renal baroreceptors also. Renal system has. So you have to understand that it's not that you have to remember only one thing about this, that there is decrease in the BP. We should understand first who can activate the RAS. One thing is that you are having a reduced blood flow to the kidney, for example, to this macula densa cell, which is present in your that DCT region, isn't it? And you are also saying that if there is decreased sodium chloride delivery. Now tell me, if you have a reduced blood flow to this region, if you have a reduced blood flow to this region, if you have a reduced blood flow to this region, are you actually decreasing the sodium chloride activity, for example? The slow sodium chloride delivery to this region? Are you actually decreasing the sodium also? So once you have a decreased sodium chloride delivery to macula densa, it also activates it. Okay. Next activator I will tell you, beta 1 receptors. And once you have a sympathetic activity going on in the body, that will activate the beta 1 receptors. So remember, beta 1 receptor activity will also stimulate that, seen in case of sympathetic. Can you now understand at least first the trigger? First, you should understand the trigger, my dears. You should understand the trigger. Fine. Now, this juxtaglomerular cells, these juxtaglomerular cells at your physiology level, I'm talking, it said that juxtaglomerular cells are secreting the renin, producing, synthesizing the renin. Okay. Now I will write. So who do you stimulate when you have when you want to stimulate the RAS? Juxtaglomerular cells. Juxtaglomerular cells, you are going to sense them by first the macula densa. Okay. So to make it oriented, to make you oriented again, I'm saying we are going to discuss renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system. This was all the mechanisms, how things are working. And this is also the organs which are playing a role in this RAS system. Can we now orient? First is orientation. I have kept these organs and I told you what is happening at the kidney level. And then we will integrate this everything. Okay. Now listen to me. Who is stimulating macula densa? Who is stimulating macula densa? So you have reduced renal blood flow, reduced BP, dehydration, decreased sodium chloride delivery, isn't it? Renin is produced by juxtaglomerular cells, isn't it? Juxtaglomerular cells. So remember, it's not something that peritubular, so it's juxtaglomerular cells. Okay. So juxtaglomerular cells in the kidney. So in the kidney, these juxtaglomerular cells are first producing an inactive form of renin. Inactive form. This inactive form of renin is called prorenin. inactive form is called prorenin. And what happens, this prorenin is kept stored in the juxtaglomerular cells. Okay, you have already produced the juxtaglomerular cells. Okay, you have already produced this. Okay, but what is renin then? Renin is an enzyme. Renin is an enzyme. Renin is an enzyme. This should be first concept. Renin is an enzyme. Enzyme works on dash. Biochemistry. Enzymes work on dash. Enzymes work on dash to produce products. Substrate. That means, should it have a substrate? Yes, sir, it should have a substrate. What is the substrate? Substrate is angiotensinogen, a plasma globulin. Angiotensinogen. This angiotensinogen is a plasma globulin. It's a plasma globulin. And this plasma globulin, or you call it renin substrate, is already present in the blood. Okay? Like you have fibrinogen, like you have, you know, albumin, globulins. Do you know? We already learned in the blood physiology, isn't it? So like that, it is circulating in the blood. Once this renin sees him, renin is secreted, because you will secrete the renin when you have this RAS system to be activated. Now this renin will say, oh, my angiotensin, no gen. So no gen is important. It's inactive with us. So once renin acts on this angiotensinogen, who produces protein? Which organ in your body is producing proteins? It's liver. Who should be producing angiotensinogen? Who should be producing angiotensinogen? Very nice, liver. So do you think why I drew the liver? Can you understand why I draw the liver? Yeah. Okay, very nice. Okay. Angiotensinogen. Now this angiotensinogen will be converted to angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1. By what? Renin. Renin is an enzyme. And this angiotensin 1 will be moving now in the blood, and it will reach also the lungs. And this is the place where your coronavirus is attaching. These receptors, ACE receptors. Do you know the coronavirus? What is the coronavirus disease? How the disease happens? It's these ACE receptors. Angiotensin converting enzyme, I will be teaching you in virology. So remember this ACE for your coronavirus also. COVID-19 disease. Okay. And these vessels are present in your lungs. So do you know now why I draw the lung? Can we understand why I draw the lung? Pulmonary vessels have this. Pulmonary vessels have this enzyme. That enzyme is called, that enzyme, this enzyme is present on the small vessels of the lungs. There are also some sites also written in some books, but lungs is the principal site. So they have present in that endothelium. Okay. So they have on their luminal site. Okay. So they have this enzyme. Fine. I'm talking just about physiology, guys. Okay. Can any one of you tell me what is the other function of this ACE angiotensin converting enzyme? By the way, I will be telling you later. Okay. So this ACE will be converting this angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2. Okay. 2. Very nice. It causes bradykinin breakdown. Okay. Bradykinin is breakdown by ACE. Okay. Remember. So if you want to break the bradykinin, what you can use? ACE. Okay. And that's why you are having. So what was bradykinin doing? Vasodilator, isn't it? Okay. Now see, angiotensin 2 will be doing some problems now. Now this angiotensin 2 is the dawn of everything. Remember, angiotensin 2 is all who is controlling now your BP. How that will be looking? But first, I want you to understand, can we remember this small box for our life? Can we remember this small box for our life, guys? Yeah? Very nice, very nice. That's a beautiful, beautiful concept. Okay, very nice. Now, have a look at here. Have a look at here, guys. How to make you understand some things which I want to say, okay? Which I want to say. Okay. Now, we will be making a chart on this diagram, okay? Making the life easy. Fine. Now, this we have understood. This we have understood. Now, see, we will integrate this on the diagram. I want you, you are so nice people and so much genius. Who produced renin? Who produced renin? Should I write it in the kidney, lungs, liver, or adrenal medulla? Where should I write the renin? Which place? No, which place, guys? In the organ first. Locate the organ, then you can write the juxta. Yeah, very nice. So let us write. JG cells are here. Okay, juxtaglomerulus. Let us write here. So we have here JG cells. JG cells. JG cells are producing what? Renin. Okay. Renin. And this renin, who produced this renin, by the way? Which factors did this? When you had a decreased in the BP or you had a hemorrhage, acute hemorrhage, because blood got lost and you can't send the blood to the kidney. Acute hemorrhage. Okay. Acute hemorrhage or decreased sodium chloride delivery to the macula densa cells. Macula densa cells. And or you had, so see how many things I'm writing for you. They can put anything in the objective. Okay. This is at a first year level what we are teaching you. Okay. You should have a full understanding. Then in the higher classes, you will keep upgrading and upgrading. At this level, you have to understand these basic mechanisms. So we have an increased sympathetic tone, for example, increased sympathetic tone by which receptors? Beta 1 receptors. Fine. Now what happens is these were all the positive. They were actually inducing to produce renin. Who produced renin? JG cells. Can we understand this relation? Isn't it easy? Now renin, what renin is in the blood? This is all in the blood, isn't it? This is all in the blood. Can we understand this is all in the blood? Yes, sir. Let me make a blood vessel for you. So this is all in the blood. Okay. So it will throw the renin in the blood. Okay. Now renin is moving. And you know, liver is already producing what? Liver is already producing what? Dash. Please write the full name. Liver produces angiotensinogen. It is in the inactive form, so it's already circulating in the blood. While it sees this, what happens? This renin will convert this angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. Very nice answer. Angiotensin 1. And now this angiotensin 1 will be going through the blood vessel into the small vessels of the lung. Small vessels, isn't it? And in the small vessels, we have an enzyme going to act on this. What is the enzyme? Yeah. What is the enzyme, guys? Very nice answer. It's ACE. Okay. Please pronounce it correctly. Otherwise, the name will become opposite. ACE means angiotensin converting enzyme. Angiotensin converting enzyme. It will convert dash to dash. It will convert dash to dash. It will convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2. Very nice answer. Okay. By the way, what is the other function of this angiotensin converting enzyme? To break down bradykinin. To break down bradykinin. Write it here only. To break down bradykinin. Fine. Now see, guys. Is this diagram clear to you? See, easy diagram, isn't it? And now angiotensin 2 angiotensin 2 will be going towards angiotensin 2. It's moving in the blood. Now this, he plays the game. Now this angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2 is going to play the game. This will play the game. Please understand. Okay. Number one, it has so many effects to do. Okay, guys, what it will do? Can you at least first thing tell me what it was doing in the beautiful answer? Vasoconstriction, that's a beautiful answer. On which receptor? Angiotensin type 1 or type 2? No. Receptor, very nice, beautiful answer. 1. I had taught you in the beginning, it's the receptor 1. So it will go to the angiotensin receptor 1. So angiotensin receptor 1 is present on your dash, on your blood vessels. So will it go to the blood vessel? Yeah, sir, it will go to the blood vessel. See, goes to the blood vessel. Angiotensin 2 is working on this blood vessel. So you had what receptors here? Angiotensin 1, isn't it? So it works on these receptors. It works on these receptors of angiotensin 2. Okay, sorry, angiotensin 2 receptors. Angiotensin 2 works on 1. Okay, fine. Now see what happens. What will happen? This will cause vasoconstriction. Vasoconstriction, guys, it will become narrow like this. Vasoconstriction. Dash will happen. What will increase? Vasoconstriction. Diastolic BP increases. That is, blood pressure increases. Because you increase the total peripheral resistance, isn't it? Did you increase the TPR? Yeah, sir, we have increased the TPR. That's why BP will increase. Very nice. Very nice. Very nice. Beautiful. Now, another function is that, have we drawn the kidney? So in the kidney also, here I will make that kidney. Here I will make the glomerulus again. It will go to this glomerulus. And we had an afferent arteriole which was dilated. And we had that glomerulus here, isn't it? We had that glomerulus, and from here we had a narrow capillary. So what it will cause, where it will act? Yes, sir. We had here efferent arteriolar constriction. Efferent arteriolar constriction, isn't it? Efferent arteriolar constriction. What will happen? You will be increasing the pressure. Upstream pressure goes up. Downstream pressure goes down, guys. Are you increasing the GFR? Yes, sir. This will increase the GFR, guys. Very nice answer. Beautiful answer. You are increasing the GFR. Basically, to make it like this, I would say it will increase the filtration fraction. Basically, it increases the filtration fraction, which I have to teach you. Okay, I should write it increases the filtration fraction. Filtration fraction is increased. Okay, you should write like this. It increases the filtration fraction. Okay, clear? Fine. So this angiotensin 2 is causing this, okay, to be very much lucid. Okay, very nice. Very nice. Second thing it will do is, so it is causing, in short, what it is causing? It is causing efferent arteriolar constriction. It is causing efferent arteriolar constriction. Okay. So see now. Now see. It will also go to the PCT cell. Where is PCT cell? Where was the PCT cell, sir? PCT cell, where is the PCT cell? Let us draw it separately, okay? Do we know the PCT cell? Yeah, in the nephron, we had a PCT cell. He is right now lost like me, isn't it? Yes, he is in some dreams right now, unfortunately. This is the PCT cell. So in the PCT cell, it will be increasing the dash activity. reabsorption. Very nice answer. That's a beautiful answer. So that means it will cause water, sodium, and bicarbonate reabsorption. Very nice answer. So it will cause, it will act on a pump. That pump is called, by the way, there is a pump here that is called sodium proton pump. Let us write it here in the diagram. Where is the diagram? Yeah. So we have a sodium proton pump. No. It's not sodium potassium. It is sodium proton. Okay. Sodium proton pump. Fine. Let me make a pre-CT cell here. So PCT cell. It has a pump that is called, it has a pump that is called sodium proton exchanger. This I will be teaching in detail in renal. I don't have to take you that much here, okay? Otherwise the topic will become more long, like 3 hours or 4 hours. So sodium proton exchanger will cause more amount of sodium reabsorption, increases sodium reabsorption in blood, isn't it? Reabsorption increases sodium reabsorption plus bicarbonate and water. This is causing what? Contraction alkalosis. This is called contraction alkalosis. Contraction alkalosis. Very nice. Proton will be thrown. Okay. Contraction alkalosis. Okay. Now proton, I would be writing in an alpha intercalated cell. Where are the alpha intercalated cell? Did I draw the intercalated cell? Yes, sir. I had drawn some time back, long ago in some century. So I will write in that only. Okay. So alpha intercalated cell, it goes to the alpha intercalated cell. So it went to this region also, and now it is going to alpha intercalated cell. Let us go to in the alpha intercalated cell. So alpha intercalated cells on the kidney, and it causes increased activity of proton ATPase. That means it will throw more of dash. That means it will throw more of dash proton. Very nice. It will throw more of proton. Okay. Is it difficult? Okay. But who is doing this? If you want to throw it in the alpha intercalated cell, you can't do it directly. You need someone in the middle. That is adrenal gland, aldosterone. You have to secrete the aldosterone also. You are actually increasing the synthesis of aldosterone also, isn't it? Do we know this concept? That it increases the secretion of aldosterone. So it goes to the this angiotensin 2 will go to the aldosterone also. It will increase the secretion of aldosterone. Why I am doing like this? There is a purpose of making you work in multi-direction. Okay, that's why I am not writing everything in one go. I am writing it dissipated. Okay, in a dissipated manner I am writing so that you can remember how things are going where. So this aldosterone will actually cause more. Aldosterone will increase this alpha intercalated. Let me write this alpha intercalated. Okay. Alpha intercalated cell and increase the proton secretion. Okay. That means sodium reabsorption is increased, isn't it? Okay. So I will be telling you two things. What are the functions of this aldosterone? Okay. This aldosterone will be going to, let us write here only. Let us write here only, guys. Let us make it here only. Okay. So once this angiotensin 2 is coming on this adrenal cortex, it is increasing the secretion of aldosterone. Aldosterone will now be having some function. It will be causing what? It will be going to alpha intercalated cell, which I told you. So I'm writing it here only. Alpha intercalated cell. In the alpha intercalated cell, it will increase the production of proton secretion. Which pump? Hydrogen ATPase, guys. I will be teaching in renal through the activity of hydrogen ATPase. And it will go to the principal cell. Do we remember the principal cell? Yes, sir. Principal cell was like this. Principal. In the principal cell, it will produce what? Sodium reabsorption. सोडियम रीअब्सॉर्प्शन प्लस पोटेशियम सिक्रीशन बाय विच चैनल एक्टिविटी? ईनैक, ईनैक चैनल एक्टिविटी. व्हाट? ईनैक चैनल एक्टिविटी. इफ यू आर रीअब्सॉर्बिंग सोडियम यू शुड थ्रो पोटेशियम आउट गाइस, इजंट इट? And it's not only that principal cell will be worked by the aldosterone. There is another guy coming from there. This aldosterone, this angiotensin 2 is going to the ADH. See what he is doing. He is going to the posterior pituitary also. You see angiotensin, no, angiotensin 2 is the real hero or not? Is angiotensin 2 a real hero or not, guys? Yes, sir. It is a hero actually. So this posterior pituitary will be producing a what? By the way, you know what will happen also? This will also go first to the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is here. It will go to the hypothalamus. It will tell the hypothalamus to drink more water. See how it is increasing the BP. Increases thirst. And another function is it goes to the posterior pituitary. And in the posterior pituitary, it will tell the posterior pituitary to secrete ADH. And now this ADH, which is secreted from posterior pituitary, will go to the principal cell. Where is the principal cell? Here, sir. So ADH is also coming through this principal cell. Wow, what a beautiful mechanism. And this principal cell will increase aquaporins. I will be making a diagram for you. It will increase the aquaporins. Let me make a diagram for you, okay? See, aquaporins are some channels. Aquaporins are some channels. Let me make you. See, we have aquaporins. Aquaporins on the luminal side. So aquaporin 2. Okay. Fine. So what happens is that this ADH comes on the receptor V2 receptor. V2. See, we have two sides to be understood. Like I made cells for you like this. Like I always make cells like this. When I make cells like this, what is below them? Basement membrane. What is below them? Basement membrane. And this is the lumen, isn't it? If this is a lumen, if this is a GIT, it will be throwing something on the lumen, the space. That means this is the basolateral side. This we call it basolateral side. And this place we call luminal side. So A site is luminal site. B site is here, basolateral side. Are we clear with this concept? Likewise, if I invert this like this, if I invert these cells like this, this is the basement membrane. Now, where is the basement membrane? B or A? Where is the basement membrane? Where do you see the basement membrane? Here I make a lumen. Very nice. This is a basement membrane. And this side is dash side. This side is dash side. Urine side, isn't it? Everything is flowing like this. So this is called luminal side. Luminal side, guys. Okay. This is called the luminal side. This is the basolateral side. Basolateral, not bilateral. Basolateral. Basolateral side. Likewise, I'm telling you, basolateral side has a receptor through the blood coming to it. Blood. This receptor is called V2 receptor. V2 receptor is worked by aldosterone. Aldosterone works on V2 receptor, guys. And this V2 receptor will actually increase, make more. Once this aldosterone is coming, it will form. It is not formed, but they will form channels like now, like a ghost. You know, aquaporin 2 will start making air, and aquaporin 2 will increase more amount of water reabsorption. So they will ask you which aquaporin is present on the basolateral side. We have aquaporin 3, aquaporin 4. This is present on the basolateral side. And which aquaporin is on the luminal side? It is the aquaporin 2. They will be asking you this question. And they will ask you ADH acts on which receptor? ADH acts on which receptor? Guys, answer. Which receptor does aldosterone act? Not aldosterone, actually, ADH. You should write ADH, not aldosterone. I'm sorry. ADH. ADH will act on, really sorry, ADH acts on V2 receptor. So antidiuretic means no diuresis. That means more water which is coming here will be absorbed. More water absorbed, that is less water in the urine. Are we absorbing the water or not? Yes, sir, we are actually conserving the water and increasing the blood pressure. Are we clear? Very nice. have we understood this concept? Have we first understood this everything? I will be giving you in the end a review. Now let us play with them. We have now known the functions. Now listen guys, listen, have a look and then we write. Have a look at this diagram. Now let us understand, integrate these, all these things. Now let me start and you should just look at the diagram. Okay, just look at the diagram. What I said is, if you have a acute hemorrhagic episode, or you have a decreased BP, or you have a decreased sodium delivery to macula densa cells, or you have a increased sympathetic tone, you will be having stimulation of, you will be actually decreasing the renal perfusion pressure, isn't it? You will be decreasing the RPP. It's because RPP is less, renal perfusion pressure is less, isn't it? RPP is less, renin will get stimulated. Now this renin will be already formed in the preformed form, that is prorenin. And once you start stimulating these JG cells, which are storing that prorenin form, they will produce that renin. And now this renin, since the renin is more, and you already have liver, which is producing the angiotensinogen, and angiotensinogen, which is as a pro form, which is in a pro form, okay, with more amino acids in it, gets converted by renin into angiotensin 1. Okay, so renin converts angiotensinogen, liver angiotensinogen, into angiotensin 1. Now this angiotensin 1 is moving in the blood. As it passes through the small capillaries in the lungs, it converts, these lung capillaries will convert it into angiotensin 2. So angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 conversion is happening in the lungs. Okay, now this angiotensin 2 becomes the hero. He does many things. First primary thing which is doing is, it is increasing the aldosterone. It is increasing the aldosterone. Since it increases the aldosterone will have its own functions. This aldosterone secretion from the adrenal cortex will go to the alpha integrated cell. Will there increase the activity of hydrogen ATPase. Once the hydrogen ATPase activity is increased, there is more production of protons. Another thing which the aldosterone does is that it goes to the principal cells. In the principal cells, it will increase the sodium reabsorption and will oppositely secrete the potassium. Sodium is reabsorbed because you want to increase the blood pressure. Now, because water follows sodium also, that's why it is doing this. And also potassium will be thrown out due to this pump activity, because you have a sodium potassium ATPase, isn't it? You have sodium potassium ATPase happening here. Sodium potassium ATPase, okay? Let us write sodium potassium ATPase, and also increased proton conductance is happening, and you have an ENAC activity also, okay? ENAC activity also, should write directly ENAC activity, fine. This is how you are increasing sodium reabsorption. And another way what you are doing is, this ADH at the same cell, two things are working. Can you see? On the same cell, two things are working. One is aldosterone working on the principal cell. Another is this ADH which is coming into the principal. So ADH is purely conserving water by expression of dash proteins on the luminal side. Guys, you have to speak with me. We have written everything, just explaining. We are actually increasing the water reabsorption. Porin 2, very nice answer. So aquaporins will be expressed on the luminal side. Okay. And will this angiotensin 2 also go to the hypothalamus at the same point? Hypothalamus, and in the hypothalamus, increase the thirst center. And by increasing the thirst, you are drinking more water, drinking more water increases your BP, guys. Is this angiotensin 2 also going on to your blood vessels and causing vasoconstriction? Once you have a vasoconstriction, you increase the upstream pressure goes up, downstream pressure goes down, and increases the BP because of the total peripheral resistance becoming increased. Again, you go towards the, what else is remaining there? Yeah, efferent arteriovenous constriction is happening and filtration fraction is increasing. Filtration fraction is increasing? Are we able to understand? Is there any doubt in this concept? So what is, in short, angiotensin doing into the mechanisms? If I go into the physiology, increasing the sodium reabsorption, increasing the sodium reabsorption, increasing the thirst, increasing the TPR, increasing the blood pressure. Are we able to understand? Are we able to understand, guys? Okay, so remember, if ADH has to work on the arterioles, then the receptor will be V1. But if they have to work, if there is any confusion, please remember, what receptor did I wrote here? What receptor did I wrote here? Where is that? What receptor did I wrote here? What receptor? V2 receptor on the cell. But if I have to cause, because ADH, vasopressin is also a potent vasoconstrictor. Do you know that? Vasoconstrictor. Do you know? It is a vasoconstrictor. So which receptors will it work on the vessels? If it has to constrict the arterioles, please write that also. Here I remember, every minute of this lecture is important. It will also go to the vessels, this vasopressin. When it was going to where? Basolateral side. Now I'm telling you it goes on to the vessels. Vessels are V1 receptor. So vessel V1 and renal tubule and collecting ducts, it has V2 receptors. Are we clear? So in this way, he is also increasing the BP. Did we understood this? Very nice. Okay, should I teach you some drugs when you will be controlling the blood pressure of the patient? So what happened finally? Who stimulated renin? Actually decreased BP. You decreased BP in some way. Renal perfusion is happening. Basically, the mechanism was that decreased perfusion or NaCl delivery. But I am telling you, what drugs will you be giving? Can we give a renin inhibitor? Can we give a direct renin? Fire this renin directly with a gun? Can we directly fire this renin, guys? If I fire renin, no renin means no conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. That means no further processes. Can I kill this directly? Let us kill this. Let me take a new color. Yeah, let us take sparkle colors for the drugs. So you will be inhibiting this renin. We have two drugs. Kiran, Alice Kiran. Alice Kiran is one drug that can directly kill this renin. Inhibit this renin. Ramikiran. Okay. Understood. Alice Kiran, Ramikiran. It feels like Alice is a girl and Rami is a boy, isn't it? Kiran, Alice Kiran, Ramikiran. Can I give this inhibitor of this enzyme, a drug that can inhibit this enzyme, so that I am not able to produce angiotensin 2? If I am not able to produce angiotensin 2, no vasoconstriction, no sodium reabsorption, no ADH, no BP increases, no thirst mechanism, no all these things. So what are the inhibitors? Those are called ACE inhibitors. They all start with the end name PRIL. Their end name is PRIL, like enalapril, like lisinopril, like risinopril. So enalapril, lisinopril. Are we clear? Enalapril, lisinopril, lisino, lisinopril, lisinopril. Fine. And remember, I want to hear for your understanding in your higher classes, please understand, it's not only that this angiotensin 1 will be converted to angiotensin 2 by the ACE enzyme. Okay, there is also one enzyme pathway that is called non-ACE pathway. Please remember here, I forgot to tell you, there is also one pathway called non-ACE pathway, that is called that is called kinase enzyme pathway. So remember, angiotensin 2 is not only produced by ACE, it is also produced by some other pathways also. Important question. Okay, clear? So what drugs will you give at this level? ACE inhibitor. ACE inhibitor is enalapril, lisinopril. But if you are increasing the non-ACE pathway, kinase pathway, then yeah, definitely there will be some production of ACE. They're not able to stop it. Now, okay, sir, we failed everywhere. We failed on angiotensin, we failed on ACE. Can I give a blocker? Because angiotensin goes to its receptors on the 81 receptors. What receptors are present on here? 81 receptors, isn't it? I wrote here 81 receptor. Angiotensin 1 receptors are the receptors on which angiotensin 2 works. 81 receptors are the receptors on which angiotensin 2 works. I am telling you, if this angiotensin 2 comes here, it will cause vasoconstriction. But if I have a drug so that I can block it, will it constrict? Will the angiotensin 2 be able to stimulate this constriction? No, sir. Can I give angiotensin receptor blocker, ARB, to inhibit this? What are the ARBs? They all start with sartan. Sartan. So low sartan. Valsartan. Telmisartan. Candy sartan. So many sartans. I can write so many, but just controlling here. So valsartan, irbesartan, candy sartan, telmisartan, aprosartan. Okay. Are we able to understand this concept? Is it easy or not? How you are as a doctor doing? Can you see how as a doctor you are protecting? Yeah. How beautifully you are actually trying to decrease the BP. Okay. Can I give also something so that I can do mess with this aldosterone? Because aldosterone was also doing something, isn't it? Aldosterone was also playing the game. Do we remember the game? Do we know the game? What aldosterone did? Who can tell me? Aldosterone game. Yeah. Aldosterone, guys. Aldosterone game. So for inhibiting aldosterone, what I can give? What to write? Where to write? Yeah. So for inhibiting this aldosterone, let us inhibit this aldosterone. We have spironolactone. And we have haplerenone. Spironolactone. Haplerenone. You know, by the way, aldosterone was having also an effect on the heart. You know what? It did cardiac remodeling. It was doing cardiac remodeling. Okay. In patients of hypertension, this aldosterone was causing left ventricular hypertrophy. Okay. Fine. So we are also using these. Spironolactone, haplerenone. Can we understand how we as a doctor are treating the blood pressure hypertension people? Can we know as a doctor? So now let's have a review, guys. Let's have a review. This is actually an interesting integrated lecture where I have told everything. I have pretty much covered everything which you need at your level. It's more than enough. Fine. Clear? Yeah. Okay. There is a concept called Goldblatt's hypertension. What is Goldblatt's hypertension? Anyone? Let us write. Then we have a review at the end. What is Goldblatt hypertension? You should write yes or no. At least so that I don't wait. Goldblatt's hypertension. What is Goldblatt's hypertension? Third year, what happened? What happened to you? Don't study. So we have one kidney Goldblatt, one kidney gallbladder hypertension and we have two kidney gallbladder hypertension. Two kidney gallbladder hypertension. Okay. We have one kidney hypertension. We have two kidney gallbladder hypertension. Fine. So what is one kidney? For example, if you remove one kidney, okay, and if you put constrictor, vasoconstrictor on a renal artery of that normal functioning artery. So I had one artery. Okay. I removed this. Okay. And now this is the one kidney which is inside and I put here some vasoconstrictor. But it has been seen that within minutes, what a beautiful mechanism. This arterial pressure begins to rise. Arterial pressure begins to rise. And this remains for days. And the hypertension, the high blood pressure, which is produced by this one kidney is called gallbladder hypertension. One kidney gallbladder hypertension. And the reason for this hypertension is because RAS, renin angiotensin mechanism. Primary mechanism is RAS. Secondary, next mechanism is fluid retention. Can we understand now this disease also? Perfusion, all problems perfusion. Yeah. What is two kidney gallbladder hypertension? Two kidney gallbladder hypertension means when you constrict one kidney's artery and you keep the other kidney normal. What did I say? Let me say. If hypertension happens, artery to one kidney is constricted, while the artery in the second kidney is kept normal. This is called two kidney gallbladder hypertension. Are we having any doubt in this? Can we have a review of the drugs as a doctor? Yeah. Now, see, I had a patient and I wanted to give, he was a patient of chronic hypertension and I came to know he is having hypertension. Okay. Chronic hypertension patient. And a little student came and he said, I want to give aliskiren. What things will come in my mind? Aliskiren. A junior doctor tells me, I want to give aliskiren. First, I should say what it is. It is renin inhibitor. Very nice answer. Very nice answer. Beautiful answer, everyone. It's a renin inhibitor. What will it do? It will not let the angiotensinogen to get converted into angiotensin 1. Very nice answer. Now next person, he tells me, very nice, you're answering. Next person comes and he says, I have given lisinopril to the patient. This patient was on lisinopril. Listen to the question first. The patient told me, please wait, please listen to the question. He gave me lisino. I saw the prescription and I saw it was lisinopril. Now lisinopril comes in my mind. What first I should think, what is this inhibitor of? Can I get that in the brain? Beautiful answer. It is inhibitor of ACE. It is ACE inhibitor. Very nice answer. It will not let DASH to be formed. It will not let DASH to be formed. Beautiful answer. Beautiful answer. Beautiful answer. Angiotensin 2. Will I be having vasoconstriction now? No. Will I be having stimulation of the principle and all that? No, sir. Will I be having thirst? No, sir. Will I be having ADH increase? No, sir. Angiotensin is not there, sir. How can I do this? Very nice answer. Now next patient comes and I came to know he is taking losartan, candy sartan, tell me sartan, his sartan, her sartan, my sartan. What should I think? First, what it is? First, you should tell me what it is. It is an angiotensin receptor blocker.
Very nice answer. It blocks the receptor. Sartans block. Aprils inhibit blocker. Will I be having aldosterone release? No, sir. Will I be having AT1 mediated vasoconstrictive? No, sir. Next, I have a new student in the class. He says aldosterone. First day, MBBS student comes and he says aldosterone. I will say pharmacology. What drug he will say? Aldosterone is to dash. No, you should say spironolactone. So drug inhibiting this, eplerenone, spironolactone. Are we clear? Can I use it in patients with cardiac remodeling? Because due to the aldosterone and chronic hypertension, people having cardiac remodeling, left heart has enlarged. Can I give this inhibitor spironolactone, eplerenone? Okay. Now. A female, once upon a time, I was in a hospital. Okay. And I was sitting and there came a female. So she said, doctor, I'm having a headache. Okay. So give me some paracetamol. I said, no, I can't give paracetamol. How can I give paracetamol? I should check your blood pressure. I checked her blood pressure and blood pressure was shooting 160. What I did was I give the female candesartan. I give losartan. Okay. Losartan was given. And the female on next day comes to me telling that, doctor, where is Dr. Me? Where is Dr. Me? So my colleague says, Dr. Me, he's in the cath lab. Okay. He's doing cardiac catheterization. Now I come back after cardiac catheterization. This female is waiting with angry, with a red face. And she is so much angry, she is going to kill me. And she is also literate, Google literate. Okay. She goes to the Google and she has seen on the Google that there is some creatinine has increased. She says, oh my God, doctor, you have killed me. I have been taking your drug. It's not that another day. Think that she comes to me after 1 month and she's taking her creatinine. And creatinine is becoming high. She says, you have ruined my kidneys because creatinine shows me the function of kidneys. At least you know this. Creatinine shows us the kidney of. She says, doctor, I have been taking your candesartan. I have been taking your candesartan for so much time. And you are showing me my kidneys are getting ruined. What sort of a doctor you are? So what I did was, I said, let's have a tea. I took her with me. In spite of being hypertensive, I brought her to the canteen and made her cool down. Okay, I'm just making a story. And she told me, I brought my iPad and I started drawing this diagram. So I said, Mrs. Jennifer, you were having increase in the angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 was doing vasoconstriction. Angiotensin 2 did vasoconstriction. I gave angiotensin receptor blocker, sartan. Sartan dilated this efferent arteriole. That means GFR will decrease. GFR will decrease means creatinine will be little bit increased. And from the knowledge of Harrison, from the knowledge of my medicine, what my medicine has taught me, that this minor rise of creatinine is allowed because the patient is on candesartan. Are we clear? So now she gets satisfied. Okay. This is the way we teach the patients, not to fight with them. Just make them literate, teach them in simple words. Are we clear? So I hope you have enjoyed this topic. I have integrated everything. So see you all in the next lecture. Take care and bye-bye.